it. Working from within the system, do you feel that maybe what you're trying to do is misunderstood, or it is a pretty tough time to be trying to really build from the beginning this foreign policy?
I think I will also stay here also because I feel that the acoustic is probably better. To answer your question, I think it's tough time. We are doing it. And of course, you wouldn't be surprised to hear such a positive answer from my side. But to some extent, I'm really convinced that this is actually the case. And I will try to explain why. Of course, we live in difficult times. And it's not for me to comment on the Eurozone crisis, also because I'm not an expert. But at the same time, this was compounded in the field of foreign policy that by the fact that while the rest of the world, and in particular our southern neighborhood, was changing, was undergoing historic transformations, the EAS was busy establishing itself. There were hundreds of selection procedures, interviews, thousands of interviews, and even more thousands of candidates, one of them myself. At the same time, the EU did manage to address the challenges of those transformations, as I will say later. But here, I also want to call for, from the perspective of a non-expert, for a sense of perspective, so to say. Because at the end, the outlook of Europe's decline, of which there is much talk around, may not necessarily be the right one. And just to prove my point, I like to quote an article which Paul Krugman, now you think of what Paul Krugman is writing now, he posted on his blog in 99. The title says it all. It was Why Germany Can't, with K, Compete. And in those days, Krugman was not alone in thinking that. And this is just to indicate, 99 was 13 years ago, that performances and perceptions may indeed change very rapidly. But of course, the crisis is there, the crisis is very serious. It affects also the performance of the EU in the field of foreign affairs. But like with all crises, there is an opportunity. And I think the opportunity for us, for European diplomats dealing with the outside world, is especially to learn to be a bit more humble. Here I borrow from what Mark was saying before. I think the one thing we have to, as Europeans, and in particular in our field, learn to do is to listen to the others and to understand their perception of things. This is all the more necessary, because in the world where we are living, it's a reality that the West is less in a position than it used to be to call the shots. And even the normative power we rightly, frequently pride ourselves with is called into question. This is resented by many as unilaterally sometimes. So we need to become better at understanding the other, better at listening before preaching, and probably better stop preaching altogether. Also because in this world, you have several definitions, multipolar, polycentric. I even heard recently the word polypolar. Just to add to the plurality of this, we may have universal values, but those values don't necessarily mean the same to all those who believe in them. The perceptions and so the prescriptions for those perceptions may vary according to culture, history, and geography. Like history didn't end, geography still matters. Think of the concept of democracy, freedom, accountable government, individual freedoms in particular, or think also of the role of secularism and the issue of the place that religion or religious belief occupies in a society. These are all issues the EU is trying to, the EAS in particular, while still in the process of establishing itself, to confront himself with and to move forward as well. And I think we need also to match our rhetoric with actions. If we, and here is my very personal view, Of course, not everyone may agree, and it's definitely not official policy, but if we say that we recognize the rise of the new powers, the global powers, we should be able to match our words with the consistent action. And the history shows, also the recent history, that we tend to act rather in favor of the status quo. As I said, at the EAS we are engaged in this learning process, and you have to bear in mind, of course, you would expect this is the easiest of defensive lines to say. The EAS is still a relatively young creature, with time it can only improve, and the way the European foreign policy has to work does require time and patience, and patience to establish the right balance in the division of labor, which is indispensable between what is done at EU level and what is done at member states level. Not to forget, as Mark also pointed out, that member states remain key stakeholders of foreign policy, and the EAS was never established to replace national diplomacies. This is even written in a statement attached to the Treaty of Lisbon. And patience is required by definition in foreign policy, which is a line of business which can hardly yield immediate results, which is also why we are working now on our relations with strategic partners, but you can't expect immediate tangible progress or results in that. And here I have to say that given all the challenging circumstances in which it had to operate, the EAS was not doing so poorly after all in its first year of life. Take, for example, the response to the transformations in the southern neighborhood. I mean, in particular, two strategic documents known as the Joint Communication on Democracy and Shared Prosperity and the EMP Review. There are quite significant innovations in those documents. You know probably the More for More slogan or the Deep Democracy slogan, but there is more than that. And, for example, there is the recognition of the principle of ownership of this process by the local populations, which is, for me, a clear break with some paternalistic, if one can say so, practices of the past. And also the importance of establishing a dialogue going beyond governments, engaging directly with civil societies, which is not only revolutionary in many respects, but it's also sensible policy if one thinks of the fluid nature of the transitions which are underway, where they are underway. But take also Iran, which is, I mean, of course, as Javier Solana knows better than anyone else here, probably the hottest of the international issues, and where the EU is at the front seat of efforts aimed at to develop a diplomatic solution by addressing the international community's concern about the nature of the nuclear program, not without some limited, of course, success, with the fingers duly crossed, because one never knows. And in this, the EU has shown also the evolving nature of its foreign policy. One of the old saying was that the EU likes to speak softly and carry a big carrot. But in the case of Iran, I mean, we have shown, probably to the surprise of the Iranians themselves, that there is also some not too small stick attached to our words. And even on Libya, I mean, of course, here it's easy to point out to our divisions, which were there, but the EU and the EAS and the High Representative in particular have been quite instrumental in a group which is relatively not so well known, called the Cairo Group, joining together all international organizations, the UN, the Arab League, the Organization of Islamic Countries, to forge a much needed consensus on the way forward. And you may recall that prior to that, several African countries and the African Union itself was very skeptical on the military action taken against the Gaddafi regime. I mean, of course, there are many problematic aspects in our efforts to innovate our way of proceeding. Take, for example, conditionality. How can conditionality work without the big prospect, the big carrot in this case, of enlargement? Or take also the emerging reality of new political actors, Islamist parties in the region, in our southern neighborhood. These are questions that need to be addressed. And of course, an effective answer is much easier to be found in theory than to be put in practice. But, I mean, you know, there is a paradox here in the world we are living. In a world where probably the demand for Europe is is rising, while at the same time Europe is indeed inward looking because of its economic and financial, and now I should say also political predicament. But there is an increasing demand for Europe indeed, on the part of the United States. I mean, of course I'm biased if I say that, but the administration in Washington, President Obama and Hillary Clinton in particular, are among the most fervent supporters of a stronger EU on the international scene and on a more effective external action service. And also, if you look at the international behavior of the current administration, it seems to have taken a leaf from the European doctrine of resorting to all tools available in our foreign policy toolbox. But the same is true also with other strategic partners, you know, from Russia to China, from India to Brazil, because there is a demand for stronger cooperation to better address the big problems that we face: climate change, regional crisis, and also cybersecurity. And it is the very nature of the problem themselves, which are very complex and multifaceted and require a very sophisticated and multifaceted response. And EU, here I was quoting from Anne-Marie Slaughter, you know, the ideal organization for the networked society, is best placed to provide effective answers to those challenges. Indeed, I mean, the crisis where we are, we can't deny the dangers we face, the danger of turning even more towards ourselves, of deluding ourselves that we can isolate ourselves from problems, whereas probably the consequence of all this would be that we would isolate ourselves from opportunities, and the global dangers we face, we could never entirely isolate effectively. This is indeed a risk in the current situation. But I think the choice will be made in the opposite direction. I mean, Europe, throughout its history, has always been at its best when it was open and looking outside instead of inside. And the EU has not stopped being open. I mean, don't forget that a new member is joining Croatia from July. And the example of the Eurasian integration, which was made previously by our Russian friend, shows that Europe has not entirely lost its power as an effective model for the rest of the world. Finally, I should also quote Jean Monnet, probably in Schuman's days, an appropriate quote, saying that Europe has been forged through crisis, and so, you know, so far it has always been able to grow from the crisis, to grow stronger and better. And I want to conclude with a note of optimism that this will continue to be the case also now. Thanks.